In this video, we're discussing vectors. Vectors are arrows which represent things. Some things we measure in physics, they actually have a direction. So for example, velocity. We can speed up going north or we can speed up going south. We have a direction. Same with acceleration, same with momentum, same with force. All of these things have direction, and therefore they're called vectors. If we were talking about something like weight, for example, weight can't have a direction. You can't say, I have a mass of 50 kgs to the north. It just doesn't make any sense. So therefore, we're going to look at how we use vectors when talking about these vector quantities here. So the first thing you need to know is that the size of the quantity is shown by the length of an arrow, because we're going to represent all of these vectors by arrows. So a bigger vector, so if you have a big velocity or a big acceleration, you're going to have a big arrow. If you only have a small momentum or a small force, you're going to have a small arrow. In the same way, the direction of the quantity shown, so the direction of the force or the velocity, is shown by the direction of the arrow. So for example, I could say that I'm traveling at 5 meters per second, that's my velocity, in a northeast direction. And that would be shown by this green arrow here. Whereas if, for example, I was going at 7 meters per second in the same direction, that would be a bigger arrow, but the direction would be exactly the same. And that's because the size of the quantity is shown by the length of the arrow. A bigger size, a bigger arrow. In the same way, the direction of the quantity is shown by the direction of the arrow. So if we had the same speed pointing east, for example, we would have to draw the arrow, the same length, but in a different direction. It would be pointing east. And that is how we draw vectors. Now we're going to look at a couple of applications of vectors in this video, and most of these are going to be quite applicable to what you're doing in your tests. So let's have a look at some. Here we have a ball, and this ball is traveling over to the right-hand side. So say this is a ping pong ball, it travels over to the right, and it gets hit by a ping pong ball bat. Now this bat whacks it over, it has a force coming down in this bottom left-hand corner direction, and then the ball gets pushed downwards after the bat has hit it. So a couple of things occur here. Firstly, the ball had an initial velocity, which was going straight to the right. Then the velocity changed when the bat hit it, and then we had a final velocity coming downwards. Now just to note, this change in velocity came from the bat hitting it in this bottom left-hand corner direction, the same direction as the force. So what we're going to do is we're going to look at the relationship between this change in velocity, the initial velocity in the direction it was going, and the final velocity. We're going to get a bit more dry and just look at some arrows and some formulas about how we do this. In a nutshell though, you have an initial velocity, it changes, and then you have a final velocity. And that's what this first formula is showing. Your initial velocity plus your change is going to equal what it ends up being, your final velocity. If I put some numbers in here, say we were initially going at 2 meters per second, you had a change of velocity of 2.88 meters per second, so the ball gets whacked pretty hard, and it comes down and ends up going a final velocity of 2 meters per second again. We can put that into our formula, and actually we can do better than that. We can actually draw arrows, real vectors, that should all match up in the end. So we have an initial velocity that we have here, that was the 2 meters per second. We saw that we had a change in velocity of 2.88 meters per second, and the change was in the same direction of that force, so it was going down this way. And then we have a final velocity that was coming straight down at 2 meters per second. So it all matches up. Now a couple of important facts that I want to point out here. To start with, we can add or subtract vectors together, like we added the initial velocity and the change in velocity. So when we're adding or subtracting vectors together, we add them head to tail. So here we've got the head of the arrow, and we add the next one, the head, to the tail, and we carry on from that start point. However, if it equals something, for example, if it equals this final velocity, we go from the very, very start of the first arrow to the very end of the last arrow, and that's where we get our final or resultant vector from, our final velocity. Now, this will happen with any formula, and we need to relate those together. But let's look at how we got to these numbers. We did know that we started at 2 meters per second. We also knew that we finished at 2 meters per second. How would we calculate the change in velocity if we had to? Well, because we've made a right angle triangle, and you always will, you use Pythagoras. If you get given two of these numbers and you need to find a third vector, you always use Pythagoras' theorem, a squared plus b squared equals c squared. Now, the most common thing you're going to have to find is this change in velocity. So the easiest formula, and the one I would recommend you remember because you're not given any of these formulas, So the one to stick in your mind is that the change in velocity is the final velocity minus the initial velocity. Because most of the time in your tests, you're going to have to find a change in velocity. Not always, but often. So let's look a little bit more in depth about how this formula here would apply to this situation. Now here we've got the formula up the top. We know that we finally ended up pointing downwards at 2 meters per second. That was our final velocity. In order to calculate the change, we need this final velocity and we need to take away the initial velocity. The initial velocity was going 2 meters per second to the right. But if we're going to take it away instead of plus it, we don't put it to the right. A takeaway or a minus means this is opposite. So how we do a takeaway when we're drawing is we actually point it in the opposite direction. So instead, we would have negative VI going to the left. And that way we have VF and minus VI. We've added them head to tail and carried on going, and we've included VF and VI. Now if we want to find the change, all we have to do is go from the very start of the first arrow up the top here to the very end of the last arrow, and that will give us our change in velocity. And if we use Pythagoras, it should work out that this equals 2.88 meters per second. And this is your change, or your end in velocity. Now remember, when we're adding or subtracting any vectors, you add the arrows together head to tail. But when you're finding a resultant vector, so you're finding the change if that's what your formula is finding, or if you had a different formula which had VF equals, when you're finding that one, you go from the very start of the first arrow to the very end of the last arrow. Let's summarize what you need to know from this video. The first thing you need to know is that vector quantities are those that have a direction. And for you, at NCA Level 2 Mechanics, you need to know distance, velocity, acceleration, momentum, and force. They all have distances, and therefore, they're vector quantities. The next thing you need to know is that these quantities are represented by arrows. Now, the size of any of these quantities is shown by the length of the arrow. The bigger the size, the bigger the length. And direction is shown by the direction of the arrow. That's the angle that the arrow is on. The last thing you need to know is that we can actually draw these vectors out in different directions and add and subtract them together. Now, the most common formula that you should remember, and this isn't on your formula sheet, is that a change in velocity is given by your final velocity, and you can draw the arrow of the final velocity, minus the arrow of your initial velocity. And minusing an arrow means you point that arrow in the opposite direction and add them head to tail. Because when you plus or when you minus, you add the arrows together head to tail. That's what the vectors do. It's only when you're finding a result, which in this case would be the change in velocity, that you do start to finish. You draw an arrow from the very start of the first arrow to the very end of the last arrow. So let's look at a question before we move on. This is an old NCEA question. So this diagram here shows the path of a ball as it swings from position A here around to position B over here. On this diagram, we need to draw some arrows to indicate the direction of the velocity at each of the positions, at A and at B. Hence, therefore, we need to calculate the size and direction of the change in velocity, that's what we're going to work out, of the ball as it swings from this position A around to this position B. The ball is moving at a constant speed of 5 meters per second. We need to show all of our working, and we need to draw a vector diagram so that we can justify our calculations. Okay, so first of all, let's draw on the diagram what we've got here. It says it's moving at a constant speed of 5 meters per second. So that means that at any point, it's going 5 meters per second straight ahead. So there's 5 meters per second at point A, and 5 meters per second at point B. Now the velocity has changed because, remember, velocity has a direction, but the speed remains the same. Now, speed doesn't have any direction. That's just a number. It's 5 meters per second. So that means these vectors here are 5 meters per second long. So if we want to draw those on the diagram down here, we have to make sure that they are 5 meters long, or 5 units long, 5 squares we'll call it. And remember as well, if we want to find the change, which the question has asked us to do, we need to use this memorized formula. That's the final velocity, that's going to be the velocity at point B, minus the initial velocity, that's the velocity at point A. So let's draw the arrows out. To start with, we've got the final velocity, and we're going to make that 5 squares long to represent the 5 meters per second. You can make it 2.5 if you wanted, as long as it's all proportional. The next thing we need to do to follow our formula is we need to do minus VI. Now VI is 5 meters per second to the right. So minus VI will be 5 meters per second to the left in the opposite way because of this minus. Therefore, we could put that on, and that also has to be 5 squares long because it's also 5 meters per second. And we're going to do it to the left because it's opposite. So now we've got the final velocity minus the initial velocity. So now we can work out the change, and that goes from the very, very start to the very, very end. And that would be our change in velocity. So as of yet, now we know the direction, but we don't know the size. So to do that, we need to use Pythagoras. Now Pythagoras here is the square root of a squared plus b squared, and that gives us 7.07 meters. And that is the size and direction of your change in velocity. Now, if you want to get specific, what you really should do when talking about a direction is use Sokotoa or trigonometry to work out an angle in here. And that will work out to be 45 degrees if you do it on your calculator. So the technical answer should be that the change in velocity is 7.07 meters per second at an angle of 45 degrees, and you can draw that angle on the diagram so they know which angle you're actually talking about. And that's how you'd use vectors to answer a question.